All right, this is a Raptor 660. I've put a 686 big bore kit in it, and I ordered used Makuni carbs, the kind that come on it stock, and put kits in them because it had some China carbs on it that were messed up. Anyway, I'm putting a new stator in it. You measure these in a book. It gives you resistances to read on these four plugs. And on this one, that's the three legs of the power coming out. You check them to ground. If it beeps, if you have continuity, you're no good. It's bad. These cannot have continuity to ground. See, this is the wire coming out of the stator. So, to replace it, the motor oil comes out. These four bolts to get the starter gears out here. The bolts around the cover, get them out. And then, when I get that done, I'll show you what's involved in changing out the stator and the pickup coil. That's a pretty straightforward process. With it idling and running, you stick a voltmeter on a positive and negative. It needs to be charging close to about 14 volts. If it's not, most all times the stator's bad. This one is starting good, idling good, running good, everything's fine, but on top end it bangs out. Just I was jetting the carbs for the big bore kit, but I got to checking this, and the pickup coil is very bad. So of course it's not. That's the trigger. They call it a pulse coil or a trigger coil or a pickup coil. It runs by the Hall effect. The flywheel spins. It has a spot on it. And the trigger coil's here. It goes around it magnetically and lets it know where the motor's at when. It tells it when to fire or when to spark. So when it goes bad, she ain't gonna run right. So if yours is banging out on top, and you know your carbs are good and clean and your valves are adjusted and all that, it's pretty simple to grab the specs, the book, and check your resistances here. It goes under the frame, plugs in right there on those two empty connectors. So it's pretty straightforward. Don't beat your brains out if it's banging out on top end. You know, like when you're trying to accelerate, we're right wide open. If it acts like it's just not getting quite enough gasoline, it'll pull, not pull, pull, not pull, pull, not pull. Check these. So we'll go to I'll stitch in the videos here. All right, right here. Rotor rotation, direction coil, resistance. You measure from the red and white wire to the blue wire. There's your reading, 0.069 to 0.085. And I have 0.3 is good. Evidently, I tested one that ran fine with a 0.3 measurement. For whatever, that don't make no sense. But anyway, the pickup coil resistance, white and red wire to the white and green wire. 445 to 545. I'm going to pull this back right there, you can probably pause the video and zoom in on that and check it out. So I'll pause it right there. Now on this pickup coil, white and red to white and green. Here's the new one. Test it before you put the new one in, because you can get bad ones brand new. This said white with red and white with green. You're going to check that. White, red, white, and green. I don't have white and red, so I've got a green, blue with white, blue, and a red. Red with a white tracer, and blue. So that's going to be the red and the blue. That makes sense. That leaves me a blue, white, and a red up here. Well, I'm just gonna have to measure it. The colors ain't matching up from what the book says. It might be a different year model on this one. On the bike, it's red, white, blue, and green. Red, white, blue, and green. So the blue with the white tracer is going to be the white wire. Anyway, you just got to figure it out and measure it, test it. Right here, test it and hear it beep. On this other side, right here, I've already tested it, but I'll show you. See here, you go all three legs one at a time, you stick a probe in there, and you touch it here. You hear nothing, that's great. You don't want nothing. So I touch it, and I got continuity. Here, I do not. If you have continuity, the stator's bad. The coils have to be independent from the frame here, from the ground. All right, this first cover with four bolts has a dowel in it. Starter gear. It connects these two right here. Pretty straightforward. The little end goes in, the little gear here goes first. It comes off, see? It's got the bearing on it. Little gear goes in first. You'll find it's the only way it can go. There's your dowel pin in this hole. You need to make sure you don't lose that. And take it out if it'll come out easily, because you'll be scraping gaskets and clean in and everything, and you'll lose it. If it's in there tight, don't worry about it, because you'll tear it up trying to get it out. But you can kind of do like this on it with pliers. It's even better if you put an easy out in it to support it. Put pliers on the outside and work it out if you need to get it out. You have this oiling line here. Screws in up under there. It's just a 19 millimeter. It comes out very easily. And you can get it out of the way so you can get to your bolts and get this cover off. You might be able to do it with it on there, but I doubt it. It's too tight of a fit. I always just pull it off and always leave this one on right here that holds it. I'll just kind of push up like that, pry up to be able to get the cover off. When I take these screws out, I put these four with the gear cover right here. These, I pull them out. I pull this one out. I set it right there. I pull this one out. I set it right there beside that one, coming this way. And the next one, side by side by side. Try to, when I put it back together, this hole right here, I'll start with this screw. Because they're going to be different lengths and what have you. Not in everything, but in most things. And that just keeps it simple. You don't got to worry about it. You're not juggling screws and always ending up with one that's way too long or way too short, because sometimes they will interchange to a degree. And here's your main ground right here. Don't forget to put your ground wire back in. Right there. Right here. It don't hurt to clean it up. Scratch that up, clean it up. When you put it back together, get you a really good, solid ground. The cover's gonna be a little stubborn to get off. You can see under here, I can show you maybe up from up here. That's the back of the starter. My finger's pointing that under the carb. It's got two 10 millimeter head bolts. If you look hard, you can see them up there where my pinky finger is. You can take the starter out. Normally, I don't have to. I've got this brass rod. You can use anything, a rock, a stick, a 2x4, long screwdriver. You just don't want to beat stuff up. You just want to tap stuff. So I put it in here. See, I've got it over there on that cover. There's an O-ring on the starter, and it's kind of sticky. So I just do this. It looks like she's budged for me. So now, oh yeah, see, it's come off nicely already. So now I'm tight down here. And just work at it and pull it off. Right there you are, I got it off. Now, I've got a dowel right there. I've got a dowel right there. I got a dowel right here, three dowels. Keep track of those. See, I'm gonna have to scrape, get this old gasket off, so if those will come out without tearing them up, I'll pull them out so I can clean stuff up faster, easier, and better. Or I'll work around them if I have to. Here's your flywheel. It is kind of magnetic-y to pull it off. The flywheel's magnetized. Here's the stator, those three screws. I think those are 5 millimeters. Pulls it out. And then under these starter gears here, small one in first. I'm going to put that where it goes there. And I'm going to put this small one in first right there. That's how I'll do it to put it back together. I'll have it assembled like that. And to clean the gasket, I'll take it off. But I'm showing you, to putting it back together, have it like that, small one in first. And for years, I've used like a 79 Chevrolet 350 harmonic balancer puller. It's a 3 or a 4-prong puller. You can buy anywhere. It works great for these because you got a screw. You need a 3-slot puller, a 3-hole puller, to pull this flywheel into each hole here. I think those are 8 millimeters. And then with this nut off, you put the screw tension here, and with my air wrench, zap it off. That's what you got to do. Or you can buy you a puller on eBay. No problem. I've had that 350 puller forever, and it works great. I'd show it to you, but I got it buried over there in one of my toolboxes. Anyway, that's your starter clutch. It grabs going this way. That starts the motor. Then when it stops, the starter gears stop moving. They're here being still. And see, it'll freewheel backwards. That'll let the motor run. So that's what the starter clutch is all about. So now it's all about these three screws. These two screws. Get the gaskets cleaned up on the engine and the cover. You got your three dowels. 1, 2, 3. And possibly, I think you got an O-ring right here. So, oftentimes the dowels will have O-rings around them.
Yeah, they do. Okay, see, here's this one. It looks like that top one does not, but I think these other two have O-rings. Anyway, just pay attention. You can go to partzilla.com and look up the original Yamaha parts fish and see exactly what goes where if you need to. So with the Stator, I'm trying to find this one here. This is a pickup coil. You can see it's the green and blue wire over here for testing purposes. Write that down in your manual if it varies from what my book showed you. But you just test it, check it out, put it in. The pickup coil, it'll cut out on top end like it'll run like, And if you got your jetting and everything's right, nothing's changed, test it. Unplug it, test it with the specs. Once you get it all together, get the motorcycle, get the four-wheeler running and idling, and at a regular steady idle, put your voltmeter across here, red to red, black to black, and you need to be making somewhere around about 14 volts. That's charging it. If it's only got 12 volts or 11, then you're no good. If it's making a high 15, 16 volts, your regulator ain't regulating. This Stator makes AC current. The voltage rectifier regulator changes it, rectifies it to DC voltage. And the regulator part of the rectifier regulator regulates how much juice goes to your battery. And I do everything here, motors, suspension, carbs, I do it all. If you have something that you're not sure about or whatever, you can send it to me and I can repair it and mail it back to you. I've been doing this a lot of years. I all the time see things I hadn't seen before, but I've seen a lot of it. But this is gonna be a baby right here. I've got a 686 big bore kit in it, freshly rebuilt McCooney carbs on it. I've got the Pro Design nice air filter that bolts into it because the Yamaha air filter is total garbage, how it just sits there and the lid kind of holds it on. If you want to get a lot of dirt in your motor and chew it up, use the standard one. If not, put a Pro Design in there. Cost you about $100 and you'll have a damn good sealed air filter, and that means the world. Anyway, leave me comments. I answer everybody. And if you have questions, if you want me to repair something, rebuild something, whatever, I'm in Texas. Just let me know. One last tidbit. I said in the video they're 5. These are actually 4 millimeters. I rig it up like this. Longer extensions flex and you lose torque and such. I like to keep it short as I can. So they go here. 4 millimeter. Walmart inexpensive brake parts cleaner is just as good as brake spray as anything you can buy for a better price. Blue Loctite. Get your bolts out. Get everything ready. Spray the bolt holes with your brake cleaner. Let it dry. If you have compressed air, blow them out. Put you a good shot of blue Loctite on them. And button them up. And be careful. They're small screws. You can strip them off pretty easy. If you feel necessary, you can look up the torques and torque them. I don't. I've been doing it. I know how tight they need to be. But that should do it. Hopefully this will get us running on this job. I forgot to mention in the video, I had Rose from Oklahoma assisting me taking this Raptor apart, checking it out, testing things. I meant to get her in the video and I didn't do it. Now she's gone. So thank you, Rose. She's a very knowledgeable mechanic and she knows mechanics, and it's always a big plus when she's in my shop helping me figure things out, because you know how it is. It's always about, okay, it ain't doing this, what does it need? You're always figuring out what's going on. So thank you very much, Rose.